are you ready to hear from the Lord? We're going into 2013, but we're not the same person. Today, God's going to speak. I believe what God's given me is special. Not only what he's given me, but what he's given our ministry. And I'll tell you what, it's a privilege to be able to stand behind this pulpit where I'm standing now. To be able to look at the lineage that you guys come from. You guys are cut from a good rock. There in San Jose, your pastor was there building for many years, and God, out of his faithfulness, found it fit to uproot him with his heavy hand and place him here in Dallas so that these few hundred people and the hundreds to come would be able to sit in a service and hear from the Lord this morning. That's something to give the Lord a shout for, to clap for. Praise the Lord. You guys can go ahead and be seated here this morning. I don't want to thank the Lord for my salvation. Thank you, worship team. Like Jesse was saying, I got saved at 12 years old. I grew up in church from 8 years old on out. I received the Lord at 8 years old, but just because you say the prayer doesn't mean you're saved. Hallelujah. Just because you say it and a tear comes down doesn't mean you change a little bit. Come on, somebody. It's a good start. But at 12 years old, I dedicated my heart to the Lord, and I said, you know what? If God could use my dad, an ex-heroin addict, an ex-gang member, an ex-drug addict, in and out of prison, then I know that God can use me. It doesn't matter how old I am. If my heart's willing, I know that God can use my life. And I walked into a youth service. And let me tell you something, the gang works. The gang really works. I walked in and I seen my youth pastor preaching, and I said, you know what, I want what he has. And you guys have a good rock here this morning. You guys have Pastor Jesse and Sister Valerie. I thank you this morning for allowing me this opportunity to stand behind this pulpit and the whole ministerial staff and the leadership here. I've been here since Saturday, and since Monday, actually. I flew in on Christmas Eve, and we've been having a good time being here with the Perez family and the whole church, and even hanging out with a lot of the youth and going to winter retreat. It was powerful. I can't really tell you exactly what happened, but you'll begin to see it in the next few weeks in the lives of these young people. But this morning, we're going to get right into it today. If you're ready for the word, say, already. Already. I'm picking up on the lingo out here a little bit. I want to bring you greetings from our pastors right there in our home church in Chino, Pastor Sonny Jr. and Sister Kim. They send their greetings to you. Also, Pastor Phil and the gang committee. And also, my director, Pastor Ezra and Sister Ruthie, they send their greetings here to D-Town here this morning. Amen. And if you're ready for the word, I want you to turn your Bibles with me to John 15, verse 1. John 15, verse 1 this morning. And what we're going to be talking about today is we're going to be talking about the vine. Going into this new year, I believe that it's going to be a year that's going to blow all of our minds. The other day I was in prayer, and I knew something was coming my way because it was like I was comfortable for a few weeks. I moved from upstairs with all the guys to a room where I was separated, and I was with other staff, and we were kind of not too much comfortable, but a little bit more comfortable. And how many know when you're comfortable, God sends a curveball your way? So we were right there, and then one morning at the mother church, they call us into the green room, and we're like, okay, we're going to go check in and see what they need help with. And then we're standing there, and my director looks at me and says, in a week and a half, you're leaving to Chicago. Are you willing? But in my mind, when I was walking to the green room, I was thinking, whatever they ask me, I'm going to say yes. Because saying yes has got me to where I'm at today. And not saying it's far, but it's a good start. And I started thinking, and I got through a curveball my way, and he said, would you go? And I believe 2013 is my year. Come on, if you believe that with me, wave your hand at me this morning. I was in prayer, and God planted that seed right before they called me into the green room. You know, sometimes you get called into the green room, and you think it's to sit down and eat some fruit and drink some water and drink some juice. But little do you know, you're getting marching orders that's going to change the course of your destiny here this morning. John 15, verse 1. We're going to read about 8 scriptures. It says like this. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You already are clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit to itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Verse 5, I am the vine, and you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. Verse 7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you may bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. Father, we come before you this morning. God, we give you all the honor and all the glory because you're a good God. You're an amazing God. You're an awesome God. And you found it fit to save us, God, a people who were once nobodies, God. But you placed us in a sanctuary under a great covering, under a great ministry, God, to be able to sit here this morning and stand before crowds and preach your word, minister to people on the streets. But today, we pray, fill us up. Get us ready for this new year that approaches. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. In these 8 verses, we see the word abide about 6 times in red. And when it's in red, that means that Jesus is talking. The word abide, I looked in the thesaurus. I gave good old Webster a break today. I looked in the thesaurus. I'm going to say thesaurus. And it says this, to dwell, to obey, to observe, to follow, to keep hold, to confirm, and to hold to. In this past year, I think it's safe to say that through all the ups and downs, and all the curveballs and every twist and turns that's come our way, that God's been good to us because we're sitting here today. God's been faithful. We look at the beginning of the year. It started in January, right there in San Jose with the prayer retreat. In March, a women's convention. In May, with Mighty Men. July, we had youth convention. August, we had the European conference. September, Run for Hope. November, African conference. And December, 7 winter retreats all over the world. And that's just international, not counting the local victories that you have here. So we're safe to say that it was a good year. That God's been truly blessing us and God's been covering us. But we could also look back at this year. And we look back to July 2012, where it's recorded that a man by the age of 24 years old walked into the theater room where they were watching Batman and began to shoot and kill people. We can look back recently to December, where it's recorded that a man at the age of 20 goes into a school and begins to shoot children and teachers. It said that right before he went into the school that he shot his mother in the face. He goes to the school and they begin to hear gunshots. And the principal and the counselor, they run out there to approach the gentleman. And right there, they get shot. Die. The counselor was wounded. Then we hear gunshots and a teacher, a courageous young lady, very young in her 20s, grabs all her kids and puts them in a closet and hides them from the gunman, and he comes in and she starts telling him, they're in the gym, and he shoots her. Then it said that another teacher had her children in a different room, and while the gunshots were going on, that even though she can't do this, she grabbed each of them in the face and said, I love you. So that the last thing they wouldn't hear is gunshots. It's the world that we live in today. On the same day of the Connecticut shooting, it's recorded that in China, a man was walking around and stabbing children. With a knife, just walking around and stabbing people. And where does that leave us as the church here this morning? Going into a new year. Getting ready to leap into what God has for us in 2013. Where does that leave us and where do we stand as a body of Christ? The enemy that is attacking not only the body of Christ, but it's attacking adults and children. And I think a lot about it, and it's sad because how many Christmases that were pre-planned changed because of what happened? Presents that were under the tree that will never get opened. It said that one of the girls, she got a dress for Christmas. And she was like, let me wear the dress. And the mother said, no, it's for Christmas. So on the day of the shooting, they let her wear the dress and she goes to school and she's shot and killed in it. A world that's envying that's depriving Christianity, that's looking at people and pointing the finger and say, well, you guys don't have this and you guys don't have that. You guys can't do this and you guys can't do that and you guys need this and you guys are asking for that. And instead of looking at it like, man, I can help build the body and I can help build the church, there's people that are rising up and walking away from the things of God, young and old, where people are set in their ways. Where they take the philosophy of the doctrine and they read the Bible and they pick the good parts that they like. God wants to bless me. Okay, I'll take that one. He wants me to change this. No, God, keep the change. The world that we live in today. I'm 22 years old and I'm grateful for what God's doing in my life. But I know this, that the best is yet to come. And I believe that this year that the best is yet to come. But the truth is that without abiding in Christ and us knowing our role as the branches, that there will be no evangelizing and discipling the hurting people of the world. You know, being there in the training center and being close to the hub over there, I'm able to sometimes be a fly on the wall in a meeting. That means when you just get called into a meeting and you sit in the corner, you serve, you get coffee, you get water, and you just listen. So being there and sometimes just hearing the conversations that our founders having with the ministers. To hear the conversation that the gang committee's having. And a lot of things are going on and it's a lot of questions. Does the body of Christ and the churches that we have now, do they still hit the streets? Do they still disciple people? Because Victory Outreach, we have a special role. We're a unique ministry. Come on, somebody. You can look to your left and look to your right and you can say, man, we're unique. We have a special role. We have our own version that God's given us of the Great Commission. To go ye and make disciples. Go ye means to go evangelize, but then the second part is make disciples. So for people who don't have a church, there's people that don't have a church and they're just out there preaching and ministering to people. And that's good. We need those people too. But it says make disciples. Where are you going to take them to if you don't have a home church? Come on, somebody. You can pray for them and you can lead them to the Lord, but if you don't have a life group, hello. If you don't have a home, if you don't have a spiritual daddy, come on now. Oh, come on, somebody. I'm in Dallas here this morning. Praise the Lord. See, the purpose of the vine is to provide nutrients to the branches so they can grow and bear fruit, but the purpose of the branch is to produce. When you look at a tree, you see the purpose of it. You see what it does and what it doesn't do. If it grows or if it dies. But there is no production where there is no connection. I'm going to be talking a little bit about connecting this morning. Because the truth is this, is that we can't do nothing. You and I, naturally, we can do nothing. Even out there in the world, once I seen my dad. He thought he was running the show, and he thought he had it all together. But at the end of the day, there was nothing. Our family had nothing. We thought we had something, but it came and it went quick. You know, I could look back, and I remember when he was on heroin, and it was crazy for me being a kid, and I didn't really know what was going on. You know, for one Christmas, for him buying me a bike, and then the next day slinging it for some rock. I didn't know any better. I thought it was all right. Well, let me enjoy it for the day then. But to see God's sovereignty and how he's changing people, but it's through a connection here this morning. See, therefore, if we're not abiding in God and connected to his church, we cannot expect to experience fruitfulness on something that's not experiencing living water. In 2013, I know that this year has been a year where some of us have been, man, just faithful and plugged into the church. Running with the vision and hearing what our leaders are saying and saying, I want to help and I want to do things and I want to take my place in the church. And at Winter Retreat, that's what we saw too. Many young people who were broken at the altar, hearing the messages that went out, powerful messages. Even Pastor Jesse's message was real powerful and it was challenging and convicting to young people to put the slingshots away and pick up the sword. That's heavy. But the truth is this. At the end of the day, we have to make a decision with the side of our lives that of God being faithful to me, I'm going to be faithful back to him. so I can produce fruit here this morning. I heard a story of a barbershop. And it goes like this. There's a guy in there. He's hooking everybody up. He's cutting people's hair. He's lining people up. He's edging them up. He's giving faux hawks. He's hooking it up. Then it's said that a guy sitting down where he was getting his haircut starts talking about Jesus. How many know passion ain't quiet? He starts talking about Jesus. And all of a sudden, the barber says, you know what? You can't talk about Jesus in here. I don't believe in him. So out of respect and reverence, the Christian says, okay. He don't want to get his hair messed up, maybe. Maybe he didn't want to disrespect what was going on or cause a big scene. So he says, okay, and he stays quiet. He gets his hair cut. He pays the man. Even tips him out of a generous heart, amen. Then he walks out on the street and he sees a homeless man there with a fro, with a beard, not edged up, not cleaned up. So he grabs the homeless man and he goes, hey, can I pay for your haircut? And the homeless man says, all right, cool. They walk in there. And he walks up to the same barber with the homeless man. And he goes, I don't believe in barbers. And the barber looks at him. And he goes, what do you mean? He goes, yeah, I don't believe in barbers. This guy has a fro. He's not edged up. He's not cleaned up or anything. And the barber goes, what do you mean? All he has to do is come to me. And it's the same thing with the body of Christ. There's people that are in need, that have money, that they think they have it all together. But because they don't know how to connect, because they don't know where to go, because there's not that many people sharing about their church, about the vision of our ministry. There's people that think we're crazy. Did you know that? Because we talk about our pastors in a good way. And we have great elders. And some people ridicule us and they look at us and say, why do you talk so much about them? It's not our fault that we still have them around. So we're going to honor our leaders and we're going to look at them and we're going to say, one day I want to have what that man has. And even when he goes on to be with the Lord, I'm going to continue to trailblaze and I'm going to pick up where he left off and we're going to take the world for Jesus. But it only comes through abiding in Christ. There is many people who begin to operate under the law of replacement when they get saved. Some people it's good where they're like, well, I'll change worldly music and I'll listen to Christian hip hop and that's good. There's people who say, you know what, I won't go to this store anymore because a certain connection hangs out there, so I'm going to go to this store, and that's good too. But there's certain people who replace it with the wrong things. They'll replace their conviction for compromise, replace church attendance for online sermons, replace his presence for his presence. They'll replace their loyalty for his sovereignty. And they'll replace their commitment for others' comments. For the sake of being, oh, I don't want to get called a Jesus freak. I don't want everybody to know that I go to the church on Grand Avenue. So I'll just say I go to church. At another winter retreat I was at, they were preaching and they said, do you just wear gang gear and walk around like a mannequin? Oh, you're a good advertisement and you're a good model and you can wear the shirt and it fits you real good, it's fitted. And you can stand on the bus and you can hold the pole and just stand there looking cool with the gear on. But are you a mannequin or do you speak up for Jesus? This is the type of people that we're called to reach. But it says that the branch could do nothing without being connected to the vine. But the truth is, my friend, the only way to experience his fruitfulness in 2013 is through his word, through his presence, through church attendance, through loyalty, and through commitment here this morning. I know today that we could look at it and be like, oh, well, you know, times are changing. And the church is not the same anymore. And that's okay because that was back in 1967 where God was reaching the drug addicts and God was reaching the prostitutes and God is reaching the gang members. I'll tell you what, my friend, we're in 2012. Going into 2013, and God's still reaching the gang members. God's still reaching the drug addicts. God's still reaching the prostitutes. But he's reaching the church kids too. He's saving the young man who woke up in church and didn't even do a drug, didn't even drink. But I'll tell you what, we were so lost and bound. And God's reaching them. And God's raising up churches all over the world that are going to go overseas. We're going to see young pastors rise up. I'm 22 and I'm believing God by 24. I'm going to be a pastor. And God's raising up churches in Dallas. Come on now. In New Mexico. In Denver. We're all over the United States. That's why it's important that you go to the retreats. You go to Mighty Men of Valor. You go to Women's Convention. You go to World Conference. You know, like Jesse was saying, my dad has a church in North Carolina. And it seems like, you know, everything happens in the West Coast, right? Can I get an amen? And as more east you go, kind of feels like you're kind of getting more lonelier and lonelier. And it's just like, oh, man, it's just, there's not another church for like 6 hours, for 3 hours. Over there, there's a church every 10 minutes. But you know what keeps us connected? It's prayer. Building relationships. Running with the vision. And I'll tell you what, there's a church, and there's churches all over the world praying for Dallas. The West Coast, we lift up all the churches in the UTC. We pray for regional pastors. We pray for local pastors. We pray for churches to begin to build and grow, because I'll tell you what, as churches grow, the body grows. As people begin to be that branch, then the tree gets bigger. Our ministry has been faithfully answering the call for over 45 years. Our founders and our elders and our regional pastors for many years have been faithful to doing the work of the Lord. You know, I was thinking about it the other day, and Pastor Ed Morales, out of his faithfulness to building a church, not only to building a church, but just to saying, I'll go where God sends me, and getting in his car and just driving up 6 hours. Out of his faithfulness came fruit. And Pastor Jesse, when God told him to come here, out of his faithfulness, he said yes. And now look at all this fruit. But you have the opportunity as a Christian too to be able to produce. They're at your high school. They're at your job. They're at your workplace. And even in the church here this morning. Is there any people here that want to bear fruit this morning? I'm believing in 2013 that we're going to see more, the most fruit that we've ever seen. I'm talking about breakthroughs. I'm talking about salvations. I'm talking about financial breakthroughs. Getting out of debt. Come on now. Woo, January 2nd, get a blank check in the mail. Woo. Come on, somebody. Friday night, getting a phone call from the family member that you thought would never get saved. Saying, let's go to church. Come on, is God good? Can he do it? Yes, he could. But we got to remain faithful, and we got to stay connected to the vine. And for some, this year has been a year of just being faithful and serving and building and battling, trusting and relying and praying and believing. But I'll tell you what, I believe that by you being faithful to God, 2013, you're going to see this place packed out. Church is going to begin to grow. I heard it was packed out last Sunday. It could be like that every Sunday. But we have to produce fruit. We have a responsibility, church. Gang, you have a responsibility. Parents, you have a responsibility. As a branch, we must abide. Let's look at verse 1. Verse 1, he starts off by saying, I am the vine. In verse 5, he says, I am the vine. Our only hope that we have is found in Jesus. And since we are connected as a branch and we abide in the Lord, you have the opportunity to represent hope to somebody else. Wherever you go. But we must be connected in prayer, in his word, in outreach, in love, in giving. Come on, we're going to do it again. And giving, hallelujah. In fellowship, in obedience. And there's so much more to go on with you. But let me share something with you this morning that's encouraging. If you look at a tree, the branch is what grows fruit, not the vine. I want you to catch that this morning. You look at a tree. Excuse me. You see an apple, it grows off of a branch. You see an orange, it grows off of a branch. All those other fruits that grow off of a branch, the branch is what produces fruit. It grows off of the branch, not off the vine, but you can't grow nothing without connection. You know, I don't know if anybody's ever been camping before. Have you guys been camping before? And you're in the middle of nowhere, it's getting cold, and you got to begin to start up a fire. When you begin to start up a fire, you begin to look for twigs. and you get the twigs together. You put them in a little circle. Come on now, you get the rocks, you start sparking the flame. And that's how you start a fire. So we could say that when you get saved, you come in, you receive the Lord into your life, and a fire starts. Baby twig. You begin to grow in the church. You get the vision. You run with it. God begins to save your family members. You become a tither. God begins to bless you. You become a branch, and you begin to produce. So twigs are good to start a fire, but how much more of a blaze can we set? If we begin to see branches begin to rise up in this church, your pastor has a big vision. Just hearing about him, his heart is Dallas. He talks about Dallas. He goes to sleep thinking about the church. And you, as a church, we have a responsibility to be faithful to the man of God who's faithful. Romans 11, verse 18. Turn there with me, please, this morning. When you're there, say, already. Romans 11, 18. Come on, young people, I need to hear some Bibles turning. The gang works if you work it. Romans 11, verse 18. We're reading the New King James, and then in the Message it says, do not boast against the branches, but if you do boast, remember that you do not support the root, but the root supports you. In the Message version it says this, yet the fact that you are now fed by that rich and holy fruit gives you no cause to crow over the pruned branches. Remember, you aren't feeding the root. The root is feeding you. When you look at the tree, you see a stump, you see branches, you see the leaves, and you see fruit if the tree bears any. You can look at any tree. You can look at a tree that's alive or a tree that's dead. You're most attracted to the one that's producing. But what we don't see when we look at a tree is roots that go deep down into the ground that when a storm comes, it still stands like Psalms 1 talks about. It's the branch don't hold it from the storm. It's the roots that go deep into the ground. But let us never forget that we don't feed the roots. The roots feed us. That's why it's important that we abide in Christ. There's people and they get asked to do certain things. And without seeking godly counsel, instead of going up there and preaching, they're performing. Young people with talents, young people with gifts. Instead of seeking godly counsel and saying, God, what do you want me to say this morning? What do you want me to do this morning? What is it, God, that you want your people to hear? It comes through abiding. The heart of our founders and the heart of our elders and the steering committee is that we would continue to be a ministry that would evangelize and disciple. My friend, if you're a branch, is there any branches here this morning? Yeah. Come on, is there any branches here this morning? Yeah. We ought to be producing fruit. We ought to be sharing the word of God with people, making soldiers that when our pastors come out in the church and they're looking, who can we send over here? Who can we send over there? Who can start up a Bible study? Oh, my friend, that there'll be a line of branches where they'll say, no, not you. No, not you. No, okay, you get a couple more months. Instead of having to come and say, oh, man, is there anybody? Far be it the day from us, Victory Outreach, when the list of cities in need doesn't match up to the list of cities of people ready to go. In the early days of our ministry, our pastors had a promise from God and the blessings from their pastor, and they went. A promise from God that they would never do heroin again, that they would never do drugs again because they get delivered with a mentality like, this has to work. Serving God has to work. The needle didn't work, the drugs didn't work, the beer didn't work, that house that we used to stay in every now and again, that house didn't work. But nowadays, there's many options that we have as people. Well, if this don't work, then I'll just go back to school. Yeah, school's good. But you got to remember what you were called for. With every occupation, there's training. You don't just go straight to work. You have a training course to go through. That's why God created the Urban Training Center for all those young people. There's some of you here this morning where you saw that video last year, a presentation, and a spark came. Like, boom, man, I'm going to go to UTC. I'm going to get prepared. Parents were like, I'm going to send my children. But then something happened where that spark begins to dwindle, where the fire got put out, where the gust of wind just came, and because they were twigs, they just failed away. And sometimes it's the body of Christ too, as adults. There's a desire, and you come and you hear your pastor preach. He preaches hard out. He's right here. He's ministering God's word. The vision that God gave him, you don't know how many hours he put into his message, how broken he was crying over the message that God gave him, because it deals heal first and then it goes out there. We never know how many hours our pastors and our leaders spend praying for us and believing God for us. God, I pray that they catch the vision. God, I pray that they run with it. God, I pray that they show up to church. Pastor Rick Alanis, one of our elders, said this: discipleship is God's plan to reach the world. That's the only way we're going to reach the world. Because it's good to talk to somebody about Jesus and them receive the Lord, but if nobody works with them, all they know is what they've been taught, which is worldly things. They go right back because history repeats itself. But if we get people like Victory Outreach Dallas here this morning, who begin to go out and reach treasures that are darkness, and when they come in, they begin to disciple. My friend, this place won't be big enough for what God wants to do. I get excited when we be able to go to churches because it shows that we're a big body of Christ. And Victory Outreach, we're just a portion of the body. I said we're just a portion of the body. I think we're one of the fists, though. We're one of the fists that the enemy looks at, and that's why he tries to attack us so hard. That's why he hits your finances. He hits your family. He tries to prune you when he can't prune you. Only Jesus could. And the leadership that he's placed over your life. Be careful to the advice that we listened to here this morning. They say if you hang around a barbershop long enough, you'll end up getting a haircut. Be careful. Be careful. Be careful, church, this morning. The Bible says to be fruitful and multiply. And we look around the world and we look around the church in general. And rather than being fruitful and multiply, there's people that just want to sit in a seat and divide the vision. Be fruitful and multiply. Don't divide what God's trying to do. Your pastor is going this direction. Your leaders are pointing the way this way. You're listening to our founders. You're listening to the heart of your regional pastor. You begin to go in the flow too. As a church, we have to do that. And not only go ourselves, but begin to multiply. Where there's seven Jesses, where there's seven Zenitas. Oh, come on, somebody. Where your family takes up the whole left section. Come on now. I'm waiting for that day. I have a 27-year-old brother who's not saved. He's married. And he calls me for marriage advice. I'm not married. You know, when he's telling me what he's going through, I'm like, dude, I start praying. And I'm like, I don't know what to say. My same friends, they used to make fun of me in high school because I went to Victory Outreach. And they said, oh, you go to that gang member church. And they used to joke around and clown around in front of their friends. But before they went to the party by themselves, they would come up for prayer. Come on now, people are going to call you. But when they call you, you got to have something to say here this morning. You know, the other day, the students all went home on December 10th. And then they're going to come back January 10th. And I was praying and I was asking God, like, God, I know that in 2013, you have something more for me. There's another level that you want me to go to. There's more blessings, more doors you want me to walk into. There's things that you want me to change. But I know this, in order for me to go to a new level, I have to be willing to give something up. So I was praying. And I was saying, God, what do you want me to give up? God, what do you want me to give? What do you want me to do? You know, and not too long ago, we were having crusades. And I started blessing people with finances. I was like, oh, I'll take care of your meal. A guy at the gas station, I paid for his gas. I prayed for his family, and I was doing a couple of things that not everybody knew about. Then all of a sudden, I get a phone call, and one of the brothers, he wasn't even in our training center. He was in a different one. He calls me and says, are you at the house? And I say, yeah. And he goes, I'm going to be there in 5 minutes. I need to give you something. And I go, all right, cool. I didn't know what it was. thought it was a gift card. I thought it was, you know, a drink. I thought he wanted to talk and fellowship and get advice. And he walks up to me and he gives me an iPad. And he goes, I just want to thank you for everything you've done in my life. And I don't have that many mentors. And I know that you're younger than me. But I believe by me giving you this, God's going to bless me more. And I said, wow, man, I don't really know him that much. But that's how much influence we carry as Christians. From little investments, from blessing somebody. From taking care of your pastor and their kids. By looking out for the men's home. Come on, is the men's home here this morning? The woman's home, come on now. Some of the greatest men in our ministry were produced out of the men's and women's homes. And as you guys stand with me this morning, Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Very simple, very clear, very straightforward, and in red so you know it's him. When you think about God's word and what he's done for us and what he's going to continue to do, I'll tell you what, if he doesn't do nothing else for me, he's done enough. He saved my family. My dad's not a heroin addict no more. My mom's not raising four kids by herself no more. I'm saved. I'm in church. I'm traveling the world. How many more stories are in this room today? Of some of you young people, some of you men in the home, some of you men and women in the church, where you say yes to God and God takes you to places you never been, give you things you never had, show you things you never saw, if you stay connected to the vine. In 2013, my friend, what God has for us is great. But our relationship with him has to be greater. Where you begin to seek godly counsel, pray, fast, believe God for new things. You know, I'm believing God for a lot right now. I'm going to be transferring to Chicago, Illinois. For a few months, I'm going to be there helping pioneer the UTC, and it's exciting. And it's something that's stirring up in the whole ministry right now where they're starting UTC in Chicago. And a lot of people are getting hungry and excited to go. And I am too. At Winter Retreat, we gave a plug for it. We were talking about it. But at the end of the night, I was praying. I said, God, I know there's a lot of challenges ahead of me. I know there's a lot of hurdles. But you promised me that 2013 would be my year. And God, I'm a little branch. I haven't been saved that long. But God, I know if I stay connected to men of God who are anchored deeper than me, that you'll take me to places I've never been. And God, if 2013 is my year, then I want to be ready for it. But in order for me to go to a new level, I have to give something up. For you, I don't know what it is this morning. I don't know exactly what it is, but we'll just call it a thing. There's some things in our life that we have to let go of. Where the doors that God wants us to walk through in 2013 are so narrow that you're going to have to walk sideways and no baggage could come along. Where you're going to walk in and you're going to be like, man, I gave up everything, God. And on the other side of that door is a shopping cart. And you say, son, get whatever you want. My daughter, get whatever you want. Don't worry about who's going to help you carry it because my back is strong enough. Don't worry about who's going to provide for you because my arms are long enough. Don't worry where you're stepping next because I've seen it already. Come on, somebody. I know this year that God's going to blow our mind. We could look back at victories that we had as a church. We could look back at defeat that we had as a nation. But God came through nonetheless. And this has been a good year. And we're finishing strong. But we could start strong too here this morning. And I want you to bow your head and close your eyes with me. The word of God says in Isaiah that he loves us so much that our names are written on his hand. Sometimes we get confused because we don't really understand God's love for our lives. This morning, I want to pray for some of you this morning that you say, you know what, I'm believing God for something big in 2013. I know that this year was a good year.